So hi, thank you for the introduction. But let's start this off by talking a little bit more about me, because let's face it. So I am Stella. I am a recovering games academic. I'm almost fully out. I'm currently working at kind of an indie-ish studio, details for offline. But by night, I'm a Twitch streamer, I'm a speedrunner, and I'm a randomizer dev. And it's that last topic that I'm really here talking about today. So what is this talk? We're going to define and contextualize randomizers, such as that Sonic Adventure 2 rando thing. Talk about what is a randomizer, what have we randomized, and what context do we look at these randomizer things in. And befitting kind of a good talk for the last talk of the day, this is going to be a paladin talk. My job here is to get you all hyped. So let's start off by watching, there we go, this, which is me playing the Final Fantasy I randomizer, and not expecting to find that enemy there. That enemy was randomly placed there by the randomizer. How many of you are familiar with the original Zelda? So let's watch this clip. There I am playing with, wait, that sprite looks a little weird. Why are those enemies there? Oh, we're going in here. Who recognizes the screen? Who wants to shout out what happens when I go in there? Where are we? I mean, yes, it is randomized, but in the original, or as we say, vanilla game, that is level 1. In this case, no, it has been randomized. It is level 9. This is our final dungeon. And so this kind of is like that small sampling of experiences we have out of these randomizer programs. So how they work kind of on a high level is you have some external piece of software, be it something you download or a website. Look, one of them might look something like this. You take a ROM. I'm not going to talk about where you got those ROMs. I'm not allowed to. feed it into the program, and then you have a series of flags that choose different settings. Here you might shuffle around the key items. You might shuffle around what's in the various treasure chests. You might slide up or down the amount of experience you're getting from doing the different enemy encounters in Final Fantasy I. And then you choose a random seed, which, this is roguelike. I'm sure you know all about these, but for those of you who are watching at home and might not be familiar, this is basically just how we choose what particular random choices the generator is going to make. This is useful if you and your friend want to play the exact same randomized version of the game. Then you generate, you load it up into however you want to play these. Again, you know, ask me about that offline. And go. So what has been randomized? Well, here's some screenshots of a whole bunch of games. So the real answer is here, what hasn't been randomized? The link we have up there for debigare.com/randomizers, I did a count a few nights ago, and there were at least 300 different randomizers on that list. Including the Final Fantasy IV Roguelikeifier, which I'm sure no one here is interested in, NES Golf, La Mulana, which is kind of a both the new versions of La Mulana and the original, Dwarf Fortress has a randomizer, that's wild, and shoutouts to The Witness, it has been randomized. But cool, so we can randomize a whole bunch of different games. What things in these games are we even looking at? Well, for starters, we can do aesthetic changes. As you can see there, the dialogue in that Zelda cave is definitely not what you remember. Also, Link is not the Zelda sprite in a pink dress. Though, why not, I don't know. In the FF4 screenshot there, I don't think Sans Undertale is an FF4. But that's just a sprite swap that happens. You can randomize enemy skills and locations. Dark Nuts in the Zelda overworld is definitely unusual. Getting your party nuked down by wizards in FF1 is unfortunate, but also that was a hilarious thing that happened. You can randomize player abilities. You can procedurally generate maps. What we have here is the Waterfall Cave from Final Fantasy I, as well as the Dragon Warrior I overworld, just randomly generated maps using some interesting feed-forward techniques. And the big thing that gets randomized are these key item locations, because these really affect the space of game. If you think about a game like Link to the Past, where you have all these different items, you have the hookshot that lets you cross cliffs, you have the power gloves, as you can see Link grabbing there, that allow you to pick up boulders. If you shuffle those around, you kind of run into the danger zone, where you can run into, where if you just randomly position these important items that gate different parts of the game off from different places, you can run into situations where, well, I need the flippers to get the gloves, but I need the gloves to get the flippers, and the game is no longer beatable. So the real answer here is that this is where a lot of the time and effort in randomizers has gone into. We take a lot of care to place these key items in beatable ways, usually by just doing a generate and test. You put all the key items out there, you make sure that you can get them, and if you can't, you throw it away, you try it again, you throw it away, you try again, you throw it away, you try again. Computers are pretty fast about things. Recently, there have been a few things that have used logic or constraint systems. The only one I know about is the one I wrote, so. But if you do that generate and test, generation time can be a bit of a concern if your system is a little complex, if there are a lot of dependencies, if there are a lot of places you can put things. That screenshot was taken at about 10:30 a.m. Eastern. So with that out of the way, hey, cool, you know what these things are, and hopefully you're excited about them, because I know I am. So what context do we view these things as? So they're games, they're roguelikes. I'm gonna stand up here and defend that one. They're pieces of software, and they're communities. So as a game, if you play a randomizer, usually you don't think about it as a single playthrough, though that's totally valid. But a lot of people who play randomizers play through multiple seeds of the same game and learn and explore both the nuances of the original game and also the nuances that the randomizer provides. You have these different flag sets, if you remember back. You have a whole bunch of different flags you can turn on and off, and sliders you can tune different parameters on. And so you can build vastly different experiences out of the feature richness of these randomizers. And you get this sort of meta progression as you go through these games, where you get more interesting base game knowledge, such as that Final Fantasy screenshot of Lich being exiled to the fourth dimension by an insta-kill spell, which may or may not be something you knew about until you tried it out in a randomizer. You have randomizer-specific knowledge, such as that Fusoya challenge, which is a lot of text, but it's a particular flag that only exists in the Free Enterprise Final Fantasy IV randomizer, because Fusoya is kind of overpowered otherwise. You also get things like routing. If I go to this section of the game, what items can I get with these sets of items? And of course, things like we have this particular diagram for doing a glitch in Link to the Past that allows you to swim in the water without having the flipper item. So next, I said randomizers were roguelikes. So obviously, I have to quote Wikipedia because none of you know what a roguelike is. So, according to Wikipedia, roguelike is a subgenre of role-playing video game characterized by a dungeon crawl through procedurally generated levels, turn-based gameplay, tile-based graphics, and the permanent death of the main character. Well, we can eliminate two of those right away because, let's face it, a lot of these base games are not turn-based and do not use those tile-based graphics. So does that make them roguelike-likes? But we do have these three bullet points that I do want to address. You have the notion of the dungeon crawl, you have the procedurally generated levels, and you have permadeath. So for the dungeon crawl and procedurally generated levels, for some games, yeah, no, that's pretty obvious. We procedurally generated those maps. But for other games, you get this sort of procedurally generated route through the game. Oh, I have this item which unlocks this corner of the map, which I probably would have gone to like sixth in the main vanilla version of the game, and now I have to piece together how I'm exploring the space to get all the tools I need to beat it. And it's kind of this weird meta procedurally generated level in that context. Additionally, most of these games don't feature permadeath. A lot of them are RPGs or ARPGs where you die, you respawn, you try again. But in a lot of the randomizer communities, one of the big things going on is racing. You have people sitting down and playing a seed that they know nothing about, they've never seen it before, and they're both playing through it blind to see who can get through it faster than the other person. And I would argue that in that context, you kind of have a permadeath situation going on where you die when you stop playing the seed, because it's kind of considered cheating to stop playing a seed, come back and try to rerun that race again later. So you have this weird kind of, instead of looking at the individual life of the character, you have this permadeath over the course of an entire run. And for the next race, you roll a new seed and you try the new layout and generated space again. Next, we have randomizers of software. Straight up, these are automated procedural ROM hacking programs. They are usually external pieces of software from the actual games that go in and transform the underlying actual game that you're actually playing into a new thing that you're playing. They have known sets of features. They make promises about their output. And finally, and most importantly to me, randomizers are communities. As we all know, no system can exist in a vacuum. We require people to go in and play and interact with our software for it to actually have any existence or meaning. Communities build around every single one of these randomizers I've encountered has a community where people organize to play the game, race each other, teach new people, host events, get the randomizer promoted, and get races of it featured in bigger events. At the end of the day, software is made out of people, and building strong and inclusive communities around your software is very, very important. So in summary, reminder, this is a Paladin talk. Randomizers are awesome. Randomizers are tools for generating these ROM hacks that feature random things that the output of which you hopefully can't predict. They are very popular and prolific, and more often than not open source. Every single community I've run into is welcome to new people, both on a player and development side. And I double-click there. And if you're more academic-leaning, like me, there are actually really strong examples of interesting proc gen in the wild. So thank you. Yeah, are there any questions?
Uh, One you didn't mention, which I'm surprised by, is the one that mashes Legend of Zelda Link to the Past and Super Metroid together.
Oh, yeah.
And switches the items between games, so you have to play through both games to win.
Yes. In fact, you see these combo randomizers, the Super Metroid and Link to the Past being probably the most well-known one, but they also did one for Zelda 1 and Metroid 1 as well. There's also the notion of multi-world randomizers, which basically take multiple copies of the same game and shuffle the items around different players, where people are playing through network-connected emulators. So I might be running around and I'll find your hookshot in Link to the Past, and now you have it, but it really makes some of the cooperative experience really interesting.
Do you think there's like a practical like limit to the complexity of these? Because I'm thinking about like a randomized run through of Morrowind or something, and it hurts my head because there's a lot going on.
Well, I mean, there's two ways I want to answer that question. Practical from a player limitation, yes. A lot of these randomizers do have like really, really wacky modes you can get into, but most people are going to take those and dial them back. So I could see a Morrowind randomizer, but one that says, okay, we're not shuffling everything everywhere, but we're taking, say, the key items and putting those in different locations, so you have some guarantees about where you need to go or where you don't need to go. From a software side, no, I think the sky's the limit.
Cool, thank you so much. Thank you.